has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. Come on, bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his.
Good morning on the live stream. Welcome to Egbeth Community Church. My name is Tommy Farrell. I'm on the staff of the church here. Welcome if you're a regular or a visitor this morning. We're going to listen to God's word together. We're going to hear some music played for us. We're going to pray together. But as we begin, it would be fantastic just to be reminded how the Lord gathers us together as a church family. So in order to do that, I thought it'd be helpful for us to read some verses from Hebrews. These were some verses that we talked about in our Impact youth session on Friday night, and I just thought they fit really well with some of the things that Steve's going to say later, and are a great reminder of why it is we can come together at all as a church in the Lord's presence. So the words are up on the screen, or else you can turn to it in your Bibles, Hebrews chapter 4. We're going to read verses 14 to 16. And as we read them, it's very easy, isn't it, sometimes to just stand and read, and all you're focusing on is making sure you say the next word at the same time as everybody else. But if we can take a step more than that and try and make sure that we're listening to what the words are saying, as we read them, listen to what a privilege we have when we come together as a gathered church. So why don't we stand up, because it's a bit easier to read them then. If you're too small behind someone who's taller than you, grab it in your Bibles too. So Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 to 16. Let's say these words together. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who, in every respect, has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then, with confidence, draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Do sit down again in your seats, please. So that's just a really helpful reminder, isn't it? When we come to church this morning, we're not coming bringing our sacrifices of good works that we've done this morning, that we've done this week, hoping that the Lord will receive them. No, Jesus, our great high priest, is our sacrifice. As we abide in Jesus, he brings us to the throne of the Father. And what do we find when we come there? Are you worried? Jesus was tempted in every way that you are, but he didn't sin. Are you worried that he is judging you for that? Yeah, you've let him down and he was perfect. No, what do we find? We find mercy and grace and help in our time of need. So let's pray together as we come to the Lord. Our Lord, as we come to you through your Son, our great high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, we ask our Father that you would show us this morning your certain promise to us of mercy and grace. Our Father, we ask that you would show us this morning your certain promise of a future with you. Teach us to live each day with Jesus for your glory and our good. Amen. So as we begin our time together, why not remind ourselves of all the reasons we've got to praise the Lord as Ed and Navcha sing 10,000 Reasons for us.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
Let's look together at Psalm 130 as we come to our time of confession with the Lord. This is a wonderful psalm that just takes us all the way through from our need of the Lord right through to his promises that sustain us. So before we pray, I'm going to read the first half of the psalm, then we'll pray together, and then we'll read the second half of the psalm. So listen to this from Psalm 130. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. Father, in our time of need, we come to you for mercy and grace. We don't need to spend much time thinking this, Lord, to remember the times this week that we have ignored you and we have disobeyed you. Father, there are times we have not loved our neighbours as ourselves or loved you with our whole hearts. We have gotten on with our days ignorant of your power to resist sin and your presence with us in every moment. Oh Lord, if you kept track of our iniquities, not one of us could stand before you. But thanks to the blood of your Son, with you there is forgiveness. Thank you, Father. And help us, Father, not to take your forgiveness for granted, but to rightly fear you. Father, we ask for patience to wait for you. We ask for hope from your word. In Jesus' saving name, amen. And so how does the psalmist continue? I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. He will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. So we're going to sing our second song now, and let this just be a reminder to you that we can always come to the Lord in prayer. We heard that in Hebrews, we heard that with the promise of forgiveness in Psalm 130. So as you call out to the Lord in your needs, remember that he is there as they sing to us. What a friend we have in Jesus.
All our sins and griefs to bear. The reading this morning is Isaiah 49, verse 1 to Isaiah 50, verse 3. Listen to me, O coastlands, and give attention, you peoples from afar. The Lord called me from the womb, from the body of my mother. He named my name. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver he hid me away. And he said to me, you are my servant Israel, in whom I will be glorified. But I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my right is with the Lord, and my recompense with my God. And now the Lord says, he who formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him. For I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has become my strength. He says, it is too light a thing that you should be my servant, to raise up the tribes of Jacob, and to bring back the preserved of Israel. I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nation, the servant of rulers. Kings shall see and arise, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. Thus says the Lord, in the time of favor I have answered you, in a day of salvation I have helped you. I will keep you and give you the covenant to the people to establish the land, to apportion the desolate heritages, saying to the prisoners, come out, to those who are in darkness, appear. They shall feed among the ways. On all bare heights shall be their pasture. They shall not hunger or thirst, neither scorching wind, nor sun shall strike them. For he who has pity on them will lead them, and by springs of water will guide them. And I will make all my mountains a road, and my highways shall be raised up. Behold, these shall come from afar, and behold, these from the north and from the west, and these from the land of Syene. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child, that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. Behold, I have engraved you on the palms of my hand. Your walls are continually before me. Your builders make haste, your destroyers and those who laid you to laid you waste go out from you. Lift up your eyes around and see. They all gather, they come to you, and I, as I live, declares the Lord, you shall put them on as an ornament and shall bind them on as the bride does. Surely your waste and your desolate places and your devastated land, surely now you will be too narrow for your inhabitants, and those who swallowed you up will be far away. The children of your bereavement will yet say in your ears, the place is too narrow for me, make room for me to dwell in. Then you will say to your heart, who has borne with me these? I was bereaved and barren, exiled and put away, but who has brought up these? Behold, I was left alone. And from where have these come? Thus says the Lord God, behold, I will lift up my hand to the nations and raise my signal to the peoples, and they shall bring your sons in their arms, and your daughters shall be carried on their shoulders. Kings shall be your foster fathers, and the queens your nursing mothers. With their faces to the ground, they shall bow down to you and lick the dust of your feet. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Those who wait for me shall not be put to shame. Can the prey be taken from the mighty, or the captives of a tyrant be rescued? For thus says the Lord, even the captives of the mighty shall be taken, and the prey of the tyrant be rescued. For I will contend with those who contend with you, and I will save your children. I will make your oppressors eat their own flesh, and they shall be drunk with their own blood as with wine. Then all the flesh shall know that I am the Lord your Saviour, and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. Thus says the Lord, where is your mother's certificate of divorce, with which I sent her away? Or which of my creditors is it to whom I have sold you? Behold, for your iniquities you were sold, and for your transgressions your mother was sent away. Why, when I came, was there no man? Why, when I called, was there no one to answer? Is my hand shortened that I cannot redeem, or have I no power to deliver? Behold, by my rebuke I dry up the sea, I make the rivers a desert. Their fish stink for lack of water and die of thirst. I clothe the heavens with blackness and make sackcloth their covering.
Great. Thank you so much, Kate, for reading. That was a long reading. You did a great job. Thank you so much. Let me add my welcome to Tommy's. It's great to have you with us this morning, if you're here in the building or you're following along online. Good to have you with us this morning. We're back in the book of Isaiah this morning, as you will no doubt know by this stage. And so we're going to be looking at these chapters. We've skipped over a few chapters, but we're going to be plodding along the way, hopefully arriving at Isaiah 53 in time for Easter. So let me pray and ask for the Lord's help for us this morning. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we have listened to your word read to us this morning, and there is much in there that we instinctively just don't understand. And so we want to pray, please, that you would help us this morning. Help me and help all of us, we pray, to listen to what you have to say to us in your word. We want to acknowledge that in these particular days, that these moments around your word are even more precious than they have been, because this, Lord, for us is our food and our drink in a day where it's difficult to get spiritual food and drink. So please help us this morning, especially, we ask. Be merciful and gracious to us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, turn back to the beginning of Isaiah 49. We're going to be looking at that together, and it'll help you to follow along. I have put scattered around some handouts, which really are only the PowerPoint slides, so if those are of use to you, then follow along. One of the striking things about life is how dishonest people can be about what life is really like. And if you want to prove that, if you want to know that, there is no better place for you to go to prove how dishonest we are about life than a card shop. So I'm going to start with some cards which are all available on hallmark.co.uk. First, a wedding card. Now on the front are two soft focus teddy bears, and the words are, "It's your wedding day, the first day of your happy ever after." And on the inside it says, "Hope the sun shines, the birds sing, and everything is as perfect as the two of you are together." Now, the soft focus teddies might by themselves be enough to put you off, but you don't have to be a marriage counsellor to know that it's just dishonest about marriage. Marriage, let me break it to you, is never happy ever after. Happy some days for sure, maybe even, Lord willing, most days, but there will be weeping on some days too, and maybe even despairing on some days. I wonder though whether the real dishonesty of the card is the perfect together thing though. We all know, don't we, that none of us are perfect, and imperfect plus imperfect does not equal perfection, right? That does not work. It's dishonest. Here's another card. This one has a Disney princess on the front. It's for a new big sister. And it says, "New big sister, your world just got a little more magical." Now, I don't want to burst any bubbles, especially for Renee and Mariella, who are now big sisters. But this card is not honest either. I have a big sister, and I am sure that my arrival did not make her life more magical. Unless you mean by magical, like, vaguely more annoying. Competing for the attention of my parents. I think, though, my personal favourite is this one here, which is for a 70th birthday card. And it says on the outside, "70 is fantastic, and it looks great on you. The lovely kind of person happy things should happen to." Now, it rhymes, doesn't it? But it is cruel in its dishonesty. It is dishonest about the aging process, right? For me, it's been a sharp downhill since the age of about 21. And it shows no sign of letting up, so I hate to think what it's going to be like by the time I arrive at 70. But more seriously, I think the most dishonest thing about the card is this idea that lovely things happen to deserving people. The idea that you would arrive at the age of 70 without working out that plenty of unhappy things happen to people who don't deserve them. Lovely people have unhappy things happening to them all the time. It's a ridiculous lie and totally dishonest about what life is really like. Now, maybe it is that cards are like this because we know somewhere deep in our souls that life should feel a little bit better than it actually does. And maybe the idea is that by pretending we can just ignore all the discouragement and disheartening things of life and just pretend maybe that life is a little bit better. But here's the thing for us this morning. You will not find any of this in the Bible. The Bible is completely frank about what life is like. And our passage this morning is honest about that. There's no pretending in Isaiah 49. And it starts with this thought that life is at times overwhelmingly disappointing. So look down at verse 14 and notice with me some disappointed Christians. Let me read verse 14 to you again. "But Zion said, 'The Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me.'" Now, in the context of that, it's surprising to find the people saying that about God. Look at verse 13, and they are singing or being told to sing for joy because the Lord has brought them comfort. But then immediately after that, they're saying, "God's forgotten us." Now, I think what's happening here is that Isaiah is talking about a point in Israel's future. He's standing, if you like, at this point in history, and he's talking about a point that is still yet to come, and he's telling them this is how it will feel in that particular point in history. A time will come when rejoicing will give way to despair. Now, to understand what's going on here, it's going to help in our minds to have some of the history of the Old Testament going on in our heads so that we can kind of get to grips with what's going on. And I have back here my old stylized map of Israel, which is a beautiful thing to behold, is it not? My geography degree was not wasted. So here we have the Mediterranean and a vague, not really exactly accurate map of the region. Now, you will remember that Israel has been split into two kingdoms. So it's been split into the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. So that happened almost immediately after Solomon. So Solomon's son Rehoboam became king. And the people of Israel came to him and said, you know, what are you going to be like as a king? And he basically said, I'm going to be really tough. And it was a stupid thing to say. And the northern kingdoms of Israel rebelled against him. And Judah were the only people who remained faithful to him. Now, that was a long time ago in history. Now what's happening is that Assyria are attacking Israel. And they conquer Israel and destroy it. And they take off all the people and we never see the northern kingdom of Israel again. And they get all the way to Jerusalem in Judea. They take over some of the bordering towns and they are knocking on the gates of Jerusalem. And it looks to all intents and purposes like Jerusalem's going to be destroyed. This massive Assyrian superpower at the gates of the city, and it looks like they're going to win. But then in a remarkable act of kindness, God stops the Assyrians from conquering Jerusalem by slaughtering thousands of them in a single night. And the rest of them return home. But, and here's the thing, Assyria don't go away completely, and they're still kind of threatening. So, you know, it's kind of like, I suppose, a school bully who was punching you, but has stopped, but hasn't left the school. Okay, so Assyria is still there. And so King Hezekiah decides that the best solution to this problem is not to turn to the Lord with it, but is to go to Babylon, who are an up-and-coming, further away superpower, and go, well, hey guys, won't you come and help us to stand up against the Assyrians? So Hezekiah has some of the guests from Babylon come round and he shows them all the riches of the temple and all his own riches, and he doesn't turn to the Lord. And Isaiah says to him, that was a very foolish thing to do, because a day is coming when all those riches that you've shown off to the kingdom of Babylon will themselves be carried off to Babylon, and Jerusalem will be destroyed. And that is exactly what happens. And the Babylonians conquer Jerusalem and take over Jerusalem and cart off the residents of Jerusalem the 800 miles to the city of Babylon. Now, all of this, so this carting off to Babylon, is a future event that Isaiah is looking forward to. But then there's something else that happens after that. So a new king comes who takes over the kingdom of Babylon. He's called King Cyrus. And King Cyrus does a remarkable thing, which is he says that all the exiles from Jerusalem who've been carted off to the city of Babylon are allowed to come home. And they can come home and they can bring back with them some of the treasures of the temple. And they can rebuild the temple and they can rebuild the city of Jerusalem. Interesting, it's a bit of an aside. It's so surprising that King Cyrus would say that. People thought that when they read that in the Bible, that the Bible writers had made that up. You know, what kind of king of what kind of kingdom would allow people to go back to their nations and rebuild them? That's ridiculous, people said. Must have been made up. And that's until in 1879, when archaeologists discovered, what's it called, Cyrus's cylinder with the edict written on it. And you can go and see that in the British Museum. And Cyrus's cylinder's basically quoted in the Bible. The Bible was right all along. Now, the residents of Jerusalem go home. They take the treasures back with them. And that, I think, going back to our passage, that, I think, is the rejoicing of verse 13, is when they're allowed back to Jerusalem and they rebuild it. And the drama of those events has been told in the chapters that we've skipped over since our last time in Isaiah. But then disappointment comes back in Jerusalem. Despite being back in Jerusalem, it turns out not to be the revival that they had hoped it would be. That's captured, actually, if you turn back a page, at the end of chapter 48, in verse 22. In what is a really famous verse, there is no peace, says the Lord, for the wicked. That is not saying what you think it might be saying or what it's quoted as saying all the time. In fact, it is that when they got back to Jerusalem, it was not nearly as good as they thought it was going to be. And so that is captured in our passage in verse 14. Now, we're going to see in a moment what God has to say to this, but just consider the magnitude of what's going on here. Isaiah, standing at the point in history in which he is, points them forward to a time when they will go into exile in Babylon and return, and is honest enough with them not only to say there will be singing for joy, but also to say there will be a time when you feel like you're absolutely forgotten by God. It's a brave prophecy, isn't it? Rescued from exile, yet disappointed and feeling like God has abandoned you. Isaiah is absolutely right. Ezra captures it in his book when he says that the returning exiles, when they've rebuilt the temple, they are both crying out with joy and weeping with sadness, so much so that you can't tell what was what. Now, I realise that's loads of information, but this is the unlikely starting point to our sermon this morning. If you're a Christian this morning, you have to reckon with the fact that it's entirely possible for you, even as a genuine Christian, to be so weighed down by life and suffering, so grasping the emptiness of everything, that it can feel like God has completely forgotten you. It's not just that as Christians we are still people who lose jobs or we still grieve the loss of loved ones. It's not even just that Christians can face abuse or divorce or depression or childlessness or broken friendships or chronic illness. Or that local churches can struggle because they're persecuted by the world. It's not just that. It's that in the midst of all that, and even at times when all that is not happening, still it can feel like God has abandoned us. You ever had that feeling like your prayers are just bouncing off the ceiling? Where you feel like you're no longer being transformed by the Spirit? Whether you're wondering whether your non-Christian friends might just be right about there being no God. No heaven, no hell, no resurrection. Now, let me say, if that's how you feel this morning, and honestly, all of us have felt that at some point. If that's how you feel this morning, don't for a moment think that that disproves the gospel. The gospel is not true because I feel it to be true. The gospel exists outside of my feelings, in the actions of God in history, which are as solid as Cyrus's cylinder in the British Museum. But at times, it is true that the truth and the solid facts of history will leave our feelings unmoved and unaffected. So much so that we could stand in front of a brand new temple foundation, having miraculously returned from exile, and we can say, God's forgotten us. See, this is the thing for us to grasp as we start this morning. Unlike Hallmark, God warns that life, even as a Christian, in this world will be, at times, disappointing. Now, the amazing thing about Isaiah 49 is that he more than warns you about that. Instead, we find that God has lived that himself, or will live that himself as he looks forward to it. So return to at the beginning of the passage, and let me show you, not just disappointed Christians, but disappointed Christ. The opening seven verses of Isaiah 49 are the second of what are called Isaiah's four servant songs, where Isaiah is talking about the Lord Jesus. Now, Isaiah has also called God's people, the people of Jerusalem, God's servant, but the truth is they are a terrible servant. They are wayward and sinful and rebellious. And so in these four servant songs, Isaiah introduces the people to a new servant, one who would be faithful and obedient where they've been unfaithful and disobedient. So Isaiah 42 is the first one, which we noticed a few weeks ago. A servant whom God is delighted in, faithful and gentle. Now we know, not only because it's obvious as you read it, but because the New Testament writers quote these songs all the time, that this is the Lord Jesus, God the Son in human flesh, living and walking among his people, obeying his Father and accomplishing his plan. And Isaiah is looking forward to the coming of Christ. But notice in verse 4 of chapter 49 what his mission feels like. What does it feel like for the Lord Jesus in his mission? What does it say? Verse 4, "But I said," this is the servant, "I've labored in vain. I've spent my strength for nothing and vanity." Jesus, the faithful servant who does nothing wrong, the one who perfectly loves the Father, feels like he's wasting his time, getting nowhere. Now that is so surprising. I want to prove to you that Isaiah is right. So turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 13, and you'll see Jesus express this for himself. Luke chapter 13 and verse 34. Luke chapter 13 and verse 34. Listen to what Jesus says. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it, how often I would have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you would not. Turn over a few pages to Luke 19 and verse 41. What does he say there? And when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. This is Jesus, God the Son in human flesh, preaching God's word with powerful signs and wonders, in remarkable acts of compassion and love, met with ambivalence and hostility. A mother hen who wants to scoop up her children, but whose children are so stubborn and ignorant that they're not even interested or concerned. What a dead-end mission. What a waste of time. And as you turn back to Isaiah 49, you see that actually it gets worse than that, doesn't it? So verse 7, what happens? Well, actually, not only does he feel like it's in vain, but the Redeemer is the one who is deeply despised and abhorred by the nation. They hate him. They hate him. Here is God's servant, hated by God's people. And you don't need to turn to the New Testament to see how that works out, do you? You know that from what you know about Jesus' experience. So that his aloneness grows, doesn't it, through his ministry. As the crowds of followers give way to crowds who are shouting, crucify him, crucify him. His closest friends betray him, bringing him to the point where he hangs all alone on the cross and he cries out, pretty much in the words of verse 14, my God, why have you forsaken me? And the point is that you and I this morning, if we're in one of those situations where we feel abandoned by God, if for whatever reason this morning you feel like your prayers are bouncing off the ceiling, you feel like God is not present with you, if you feel like in the midst of all that you're facing, in the pain of mental health or relational angst of our world, if you feel forgotten by God, what you need to understand first from this passage is that Jesus knows exactly what that's like. In fact, he felt it more. I don't know whether you've ever had that experience where you've been through something really terrible and then you meet someone who's been through the same thing. So reassuring, isn't it? You know, perhaps they lost a job in similar circumstances to you. Perhaps they lost a loved one in a similarly sudden fashion. You know, maybe they are likewise struggling to make friends at school in the same way that you are. And they say to you, I know exactly how you feel. And in that moment, they're going to like a kind of empathy, isn't it, washing over you. I remember it happened to me. I lost a job in fairly difficult circumstances. I was struggling to come to terms with it, and someone who had worked there as well before me just came to me and said, I know exactly what you're going through. All of a sudden, I wasn't a weirdo. Well, I mean, not in that aspect anyway. I knew I wasn't making up the struggles. And that's exactly it here. God's servant, the Lord Jesus, knows exactly what it feels like to live life trusting God and feel like it's not working. He knows the frustration of offering people eternal life but being met by ambivalence. He knows the pain of being abandoned and forgotten. He knows the pain of being wrongly accused, unjustly beaten. He knows. Now, in a way, that would be enough, wouldn't it? But actually, there's more than that. It's more than just going, oh, I'm standing in the footprints of the Lord Jesus, because there's more to say in the passage. Because the passage says more than just a disappointed Christ, we also have a glorious Christ. So come back to verse 4 and look at the detail with me. The servant looks around at the apparent effect of his ministry and everything seems vain and disappointing. But then he looks to his Father in verse 4, to the Lord God, and he says that his right is with him, his recompense is with my God. In other words, the servant refuses to look at the response of the people and to assess the success of his ministry from there alone. Why? Well, because as it turns out, actually he's not playing to the crowd, he's playing to his Father in heaven. His reward is with him. So God honours him in verse 5 and uses him not only as a servant to the people of Judah and Jerusalem or even to Israel in the north, but for the nations. It's too light a thing, says the Father, for you just to be a servant to my people, Jacob. You're going to be a light for the nations, he says. All of the earth, and the kings and the princes of the nations fall down in worship at the end of verse 7 as the servant leads the people back home to the shouts of singing. Now, there's lots of detail that's missing in these verses, and Isaiah is actually going to say more about it in the weeks to come, filling in some of the gaps for us. But the big point here is that it is from the despair and the disappointment that God brings the glorious victory of the Lord Jesus. It's from the despair that the glory comes. This is how God works. Which means that it will be true that the servant's rewards are not seen in the moments of abandonment, but in the fruit that God will bring from it. As people from across the globe find a home amongst God's people through him. Now that's exactly what we see happening in the New Testament, don't we? As Jesus ascends into heaven, having died alone on the cross, risen from the grave, ascends into heaven and sends his disciples out, they preach and all of a sudden thousands of people are gathered into his kingdom. So much so that the gospel goes from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the ends of the earth in the book of Acts as God gathers in his people from the nations. So much so that now we'll find Christians all over the planet. Billions of people singing the name of Jesus and rejoicing in the victory of his cross. And so it is with God's servants, so it also is with God's people. So notice as we finish, glorious Christians. If you look back to verse 14, you see that the disappointment of verse 14 is followed by God's incredible answer. He says in verse 15, think of the most intimate and tightest bond that you can think of between a mother and a child. And even, he says, even a mother may forget. Even a mother might leave the car seat with a baby and on the roof of the car and drive off, right? They might at some point forget that's happened. But he says, I will not. My love is even greater than that, he says. Why and how can you know that God's love for us is greater than a mother's love for a child? How do you know? Verse 16, because our names are written in his hands. Incredible, isn't it? The walls and boundaries of God's people, the membership of God's people, is something you can see on his hands. In other words, in the cross, the Lord Jesus is not just saying, I know what it's like to feel abandoned by God as he is actually abandoned by his Father. No, he doesn't just say that. He says, I love you. I'm writing your names on the palm of my hands. So that when we feel abandoned by God, we know that he has not abandoned us because he abandoned his Son, the Lord Jesus, and wrote our names on his hands. Incredible, isn't it? In other words, I don't get to see whether God has forgotten me in the relative ease or difficulty of my circumstances. I don't get to understand whether God has forgotten me by my feelings as I'm reading my Bible or praying. I get to see that God has not forgotten me in the palms of the hands of the Lord Jesus. I know that he loves me as he bears my sin, pierced and bleeding in my place. Abandoned and forsaken by the Father, that I might be welcomed by him. I think it's one of the great costs, and maybe we'll look back at it and we'll realize it after the pandemic. Maybe we don't see it so much right now. But one of the great costs, I think, of our situation at the moment is that it's almost impossible for us to share the Lord's Supper properly. This is the spiritual feast, isn't it, that the Lord has given us to drink in these words of comfort. You are not abandoned. I love you. The Lord Jesus is given in your place. And the fact that we haven't been able to do that makes a massive difference because the antidote to disappointment in our lives is not so much a really good quiet time or listening to some worship songs on some headphones, as good as that can be. But it's about a church feasting on the work of Christ, rejoicing in the clarity that God will not forget the one he bled for. Now, the passage has a lot more to say to this, but we're not going to be able to cover all of it. But I just want to finish with what he says in verses 19 and following really quickly. Notice what he says: the waste and the desolate places will be too narrow to hold all the people. The children in verse 20 will be trying to squeeze in because the land is now so rammed with people. So much so in verse 21, the people end up saying, where did all these people come from? Where are they all from? Who are these people who are following the Lord? We thought we were on our own. We were bereaved and barren. Now we've got a land full of children, while their enemies and the opponents of God's people are destroying themselves in verse 26. Now, of course, this is a picture of the final return of the Lord Jesus. The day when you and I, if we're trusting in Christ, will be surrounded by people of every language, tribe, and nation. We'll look around and we'll go, where did all these people come from? I was sat in a face mask in Egbeth Community Church. There were 75 of us. Where are all these people from? I felt alone and abandoned. I was reading my Bible at home on my own, feeling like I was wasting my time, and now I'm surrounded by this great crowd of people. Where have they all come from? I was the only Christian at school. I wondered whether I was wrong to be trusting Christ. I wondered if my science teacher, who told me I was just an advanced ape, might be right. Thinking that my mates had it better, feeling that living the Christian life was a waste of time. And now I'm in this incredible party of people gathered before God. Where did they all come from? Well, the answer is God, in his glorious power, through the weakness of the cross, brings glory to the Son that we share in. Listen, if you're not a Christian this morning, can I encourage you to come and trust in Christ like this? You will not see the victory of Christ in the successfulness of the people around you, but there is a day coming when you'll see it, when the Lord Jesus returns. Adoniram Judson. Adoniram is quite a difficult name to say, isn't it? Adoniram. Maybe some of you can call your children Adoniram and we'll get better at saying it. Adoniram Judson was one of the first missionaries to the country of Burma, which is now called Myanmar, and it's been on the news, hasn't it, over the last few weeks because of the military coup that's been going on there. Adoniram arrived in Burma in about 1813 with his 23-year-old wife, having been told by the famous William Carey, don't go there, it's too difficult. Turns out that William Carey was absolutely right. And Adoniram's wife, Anne, and his second wife, Sarah, both died from diseases picked up in Burma. In the 36 years that he was there, he only returned home once. That was to accompany his wife, Sarah, who died on the journey home. When he got back, he was so poorly that he wasn't able to speak above a whisper. And everyone wanted to hear from him about what he'd got to say, so he would preach by whispering to somebody next to him who would then preach on his behalf. The first 3 years he was there in Burma, Adoniram spent 12 hours a day in language learning. No one had ever written down the Burmese language, so Adoniram would be the first person to produce a dictionary and a grammar book. By the time he'd been there for 13 years, the church had 18 people in it, and Adoniram was exhausted. But before he died, he completed a translation of the Bible. But it wasn't really until after his death that the church really started to grow. Today, Adoniram's Bible translation is still used in Myanmar, and there are 1.9 million members of the Baptist church denomination which he started. You know, for Judson, it was largely a gloryless slog. Dying, literally for his wives and actually for him in the end, dying deaths every day that people would hear of the glory of Jesus. But on that final day, can you imagine it? Adoniram's there. Where are all these people from? Who brought all these people? I was on my own. I was slogging my guts out. I outlived two wives. I died on a boat trying to get fresh air into my lungs. It was fruitless. And those people will be gathered there because the Lord brings glorious fruit even from the seeds of our disappointment and frustration. So here's the point for us. Living for the Lord will at times be hard and even disappointing. There's no Hallmark card in Isaiah 49 for you this morning. But there's a greater promise than that. You will not be alone, however difficult and hard it is. And the Lord Jesus knows exactly what it's like. And your experience today is no reflection of the glorious wonder that's yet to be revealed. Praise the Lord for that. And let's ask that he'll keep us going until that day. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just want to be honest this morning that at times, and maybe even for some of us right now, our Christian life feels really disappointing and you feel far away and we wonder whether we're wasting our time. Lord, thank you that you are not afraid of that kind of honesty. In fact, you inspire that kind of honesty in your word and have experienced that in the person of the Son. Please help us then, we pray, like Jesus, to keep persevering because we know that the glory that will be revealed is not worth comparing to the difficulty of today. Please keep us, we ask, persevering. And please give us moments of refreshment where our feelings catch up with the reality of what you're doing in our world, that we might rejoice and sing in your presence and your glory. So help us, we ask, and bring glory to your name, we pray. For Christ's sake, amen. Well, Navcha's going to sing for us, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let's sit and listen.
Left for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let's pray. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted. Father, we thank you that in spite of all the uncertainty of this past year, that you have remained the same, unchanging, all-powerful, gracious, perfect, and loving God. We are keenly aware that we are not in control of our own lives, despite our vain efforts, and we are sorry that we are so quick to doubt you, to not trust you, to not acknowledge you in all we see and do, and to not believe that you, and only you, know truly what is best for us. But Lord, we thank you that in the midst of our fears and failings, you mercifully and compassionately reach out to us, forgive us and love us through the sacrifice of your Son on the cross. We know we don't deserve this, but our hearts are full of joy and peace as we reflect on your grace and goodness to us. Help us to live for you. Help us to neither ignore nor be weighed down by our own weaknesses, but to constantly be asking for your strength to work through us, to help us live lives that bring honour and glory to you, and that give the world around us a glimpse of your character. Lord, we pray now for those in our own church family for whom lockdown is especially difficult, for everyone struggling with job insecurity, financial hardship, the demands of family life, poor physical or mental health, loneliness, bereavement, discontentment, stress, anxiety. We think especially of all the children, young people, and those who work in education who will be returning to school tomorrow and this week. We pray for both those who have continued being in school over the past few months and those who haven't, to adjust well to the change of schools being full again. We pray for patience for teachers, for wisdom for those in positions of leadership, and for the safety of everyone. Help us as a church family to always be thinking of the needs of others before ourselves. We pray for our mission and church partners around the world, as they also deal in different ways with the pandemic. For the Grindys in Gillan, David and Amira in Gostava, Jonathan and Dawn in Athens, for Sterling Park Baptist Church in Virginia, and Ogi and Navchas Church in Mongolia. We pray for each of them to be a light for you in the communities in which they live and work. Help them to keep trusting you and holding fast to the gospel. Lord, I pray that as we leave here now, that you will keep speaking your truth into our lives. For God alone, my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be greatly shaken. Amen.
Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I find it particularly difficult today not to be able to join in the song after the sermon and have a chance to kind of respond to God's word as it was preached to us. So I'm going to jump back a number of slides to the second half of Psalm 130. And I wonder if we can say these together for the benefit of one another and to our own souls, just as a reminder of the words. So it's a few clicks. Here we go. No, still some more to go. It wasn't long reading. Almost there. Just have a little read in them first. How great a response. As we wait for the Lord. So, just before we leave, why don't we stand and say these together to ourselves and to one another. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Take your seats. So we are still under the current restrictions. So as I dismiss you from the service now, please do, even though it is gloriously sunny and it would be wonderful to stand outside and chat, please do disperse and go off to your homes directly, please. If you do want to talk to one another, come to the church prayer meeting this evening. You will have, firstly, the chance to talk with one another, and secondly, the chance to lift one another up in prayer before the Lord. So come along this evening on Zoom. The link will go around again this afternoon. It was also on the e-notices. It'd be great to see you there. So if we open up the side doors. Front row. Bruce and Fergus, it's good to see you. Joanna, thanks for praying. We'll see you next week. Don't forget to give a wave to the guys on the live stream as well. We'll just give them a chance to clear the door. And then second row, if you guys want to stand up and leave. Good to see you all. See you this evening or next week. And row number three, off you go. See you later, Crumbs and McClellans and Wellses. Bye bye. Next row, guys, if you want to go. Thanks for reading for us, Kate. Bye-bye, Pals. Bye-bye, Cartwrights. Almost there. Second row from the back. Off you go. Good to see you, Aidan. Bye-bye, Heather. See you, Schnalskis. See you, Catherine. And last but by no means least, good to see you, Jess. Hey, Yvonne. Bye, Nairi. See you, Emily. Yeah, Mosses, you can go the long way round. See you, Seth. That's a great wave. That's a pitch-leaving wave. You've just won the trophy. Brilliant. See you, Jesse. Good to see you in real life. Your holy name.
Worship your holy name.